As we have seen, Gauss's theorem was really just a three-dimensional generalization of Green's theorem. But the flux form of Green's theorem, to be precise, there's more than one way to view Green's theorem, and there's more than one way to generalize it to 3D. So to answer the question of what comes next, let's go back to Green's theorem and examine this more carefully. Let's say we've got a vector field f in the plane, fxi plus fyj. We have a domain d in the plane with an oriented boundary. Then the circulation version of Green's theorem says that if you want to compute the circulation of f along the boundary of d, if you want to integrate fx dx plus fy dy, then that's the same thing as the double integral over the interior of the circulation density with respect to area. Now that circulation density should be familiar to you. You should say, aha, that's really related to the curl of f. More specifically, since curl is a vector field, it's the k component of the curl of f. So we could write that circulation density as curl of f dotted with k. Okay, that's the vector version. If we convert this all to differential forms, it's a bit more elegant. It's a bit more compact. On the left-hand side, we have the integral of the work one form, alpha f, along the boundary of d. On the right-hand side, we have the integral of its derivative, d alpha f. That is a two-form that is given by the circulation density times dx wedge dy. Okay, now that form of Green's theorem can be generalized to 3D, and the way that we have written it out tells us exactly what to do. Now, it is called Stokes Theorem, and it says that if you have some domain D that is a surface in 3D with a boundary, we have to worry about orientations. So we're going to orient this surface by a field of unit normal vectors that are everywhere orthogonal to D, and we're going to get an induced orientation on the boundary. Then for a smooth vector field f on d, Stokes' theorem says that the circulation of f along the boundary of d is the net flux of the curl through the surface. Written out in terms of vectors, the circulation is the dot product of f with the arc length element along d, that oriented arc length element dl. On the right-hand side, we have the flux of the curl integrated with respect to the surface area element d sigma, back from when we learned surface integrals. Now, that version of Stokes' theorem looks a little complicated, a lot of symbols there. Students tend to get a little frustrated with how that looks and trying to remember it. I recommend thinking in terms of differential forms, where it's the same formula. We integrate the work one form, alpha f, along the boundary. That's the same thing as the integral of its derivative, d alpha, along the interior of f. That two form gives us the flux of the curl of f through that surface. Okay, now that's what Stokes' theorem says. Those are the formulae, but what does it look like? What does it feel like? You have to be able to go back and forth between the vector field that is spinning around, causing some circulation along the boundary, and the curl of the vector field, a totally different vector field that is measuring the infinitesimal circulation, the infinitesimal spin of your original vector field f. If you think about how much f is doing work along the boundary, how much spin is happening there, then Stokes' theorem says if you add up all of the infinitesimal curl that is piercing through the interior of this bounding surface, then these two are the same. The big idea that we see is that from the form's perspective, the integral of a one form along a curve in 3D is equal to the integral of its derivative, thought of as a two form, over a two-dimensional domain that bounds that curve. And that should seem somewhat familiar to you. That's something that we'll return to again and again.